Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
We have a last lecture regarding pulmonary infections. This is respiratory system. This is the fifth lecture of pneumonia, pulmonary infection, pneumonia. In this class, we'll be talking about mainly the pathological aspects of pneumonia. So, how can we categorize pathologically pneumonia? Pneumonia as broadly categorized as lobar pneumonia, and bronchopneumonia. So this you can see in the pictures. Lobar pneumonia means we have right lung, left lung. So lobar pneumonia means any one lobe is completely involved. Any one lobe, either it may be upper lobe, middle lobe, lower lobe on right side, or any lobes on the left side, any one lobe is completely involved, but the adjacent lobe is perfectly fine. There is no involvement in the adjacent lobe, and this infection or inflammation is limited by intralobar septa. So, when you see this kind of a morphology, then we call it as lobar pneumonia. So, it just doesn't mean that only one lobe has to be affected. It can be a two lobes also. So, lobar pneumonia involving both the lower lobes, or it can be the whole lung. Lobar pneumonia involving all the lobes of right lung. So, this is the definition of lobar pneumonia. Can you see the picture? That is the pink color, what you are seeing on your left side, the whole lobe. Lower lobe is affected, but upper lobe is unaffected, is perfectly normal. When you see this kind of a morphology, we'll call it as lobar pneumonia. In comparison to lobar pneumonia, we have second category called as bronchopneumonia. Bronchopneumonia, see what is the typical classical features of bronchopneumonia? It will be multiple patchy involvement of the lung parenchyma. Usually, it is not limited to the one lobe. You can see that in picture here, two lobes are involved on right side, both lower and middle lobe, and you are seeing pinkish dots. That means these are the involved areas, that is pneumonic patches, and intervening lung parenchyma is essentially unremarkable. Whenever you see this kind of a morphology, we call it as bronchopneumonia. I repeat, lobar pneumonia means complete involvement of one lobe of the lung. It may be one lobe, two lobes, or whole of the lung. And if one lobe is involved, the next lobe is perfectly fine, normal, it's uninvolved. That is called lobar pneumonia. Bronchopneumonia, usually multiple patchy involvement, involves more than one lobe, and intervening lung parenchyma between these pink patches will be normal. So this is the morphological difference between lobar and bronchopneumonia. You can see the X-ray pictures. On this side, one lobe is completely involved, right? You can see the markings like this, and this is the haziness or consolidation causing involvement in the right middle lobe. Lower lobe and upper lobe are perfectly fine. Dark color, whatever you are seeing, nothing but air-filled spaces, nothing. The haziness is the involved lung. So this is how the lobar pneumonia looks on radiology. Bronchopneumonia, when you see the other picture, you have both the lungs, and it is dot dot nodular kind of an opacity throughout the lung. Both the right lung and left lung, both are involved, and intervening area showing blackish area. Those are uninvolved lung parenchyma. So all of you understand how the lobar pneumonia and bronchopneumonia looks under normal chest radiographic films. This is one more example of CT film showing the difference between the lobar and bronchopneumonia. See, on the right side, one lobe is completely involved, that is whitish patch in the lung, but rest of the lung parenchyma is perfectly fine, lobar pneumonia. On other side, you see the multiple patchy involvement of the lung, that is bronchopneumonia. If you observe carefully in the second picture, all those white patches, what you are saying, they have some center or some round space in the center, right? And there is consolidation surrounding it. Can you see? There is the opening in the center with the consolidation. One, there is opening consolidation here. That means the terminal bronchi, one of the segment of bronchi or bronchiole along with adjacent lung parenchyma is involved. That's why we call it as bronchopneumonia. Bronchopneumonia. This is one patch. There is one bronchus, adjacent lung parenchyma is involved. This is bronchopneumonia. One bronchus and second bronchus. The alveolar parenchyma, which is present between these two bronchus, are normal or uninvolved. This is the typical picture of bronchopneumonia and lobar pneumonia. When you see the gross examination of the lung, this is the lobectomy specimen, and can you see the upper lobe is perfectly fine, but lower lobe, when you see, this is the lower lobe, it is showing the gray white solidification of one complete lobe. You can still make out the bronchial openings here, and upper lobe is perfectly fine. It looks morphologically or grossly normal, spongy appearance. So this is lobar pneumonia affecting one complete lobe, the gray white discoloration, solidification or consolidation, we can say. This is the gross picture of lobar pneumonia. And again, we have two important pictures, book pictures. These are book picture. This is the section, one complete section of the lung where one lobe is totally or completely whitish appearance. This is the consolidated lung. Consolidated means solidified lung. The normal sponginess will be lost. Gray white appearance. This is complete lobar pneumonia. The upper lobe is normal. It has spongy in appearance. So now how it looks? Looks like normal lung. This is a typical morphological or gross picture of lobar pneumonia. When compared to this, we have one more picture where we are seeing multiple patchy areas. Some, there is a diffuse white patch here, gray white patch. There is diffuse nodular gray white patches here, and there are some patches here. So, multiple patchy involvement of the lung across the lung, involving both sides of the intra or lobar septae, multiple lobes, we call it as bronchopneumonia. All of you understand? One more important thing that you should remember is, this is in the initial stages fine. When it becomes more and more severe, these lungs, nodules, they coalesce. They become more infected, more involved. So they also in the later and severe stages, they can also form lobar pneumonia. Lobar pneumonia appearance, when it is diffuse, multiple patches coalescing to form a single big patch. So this can also, so at that stage you cannot differentiate it is a true lobar pneumonia or bronchopneumonia. That you should remember. So when we say lobar pneumonia, all the books, they say certain stages of lobar pneumonia, all of you should understand. What are the stages? There are four clearly mentioned stages in the pneumonia, lobar pneumonia. I say lobar pneumonia. These are depending on the duration of infection or inflammation. The first stage, when the infection occurs in the lung, the first stage we call it as stage of congestion. Stage of congestion. Next stage is stage of red hepatization. Third stage, stage of gray hepatization. And finally, the fourth stage, when everything is done, you have stage of resolution. Stage of resolution. Let's see. Each stage, if you take a microscopic examination, a microscopic sections and observe under microscopy, how it looks. You can see the schematic diagram. I'll be showing that in detail in the board. We'll talk about stage of congestion. All of you know what is congestion. Congestion is nothing but the stasis of blood in the blood vessels. We have alveolar parenchyma here. One alveoli. In stage of congestion, what happens? All of you know that there are septal capillaries present in the interalveolar septa. These capillaries, they become engorged. This is the normal. So when there is inflammation, these septal capillaries will be enlarged, and these will be filled up with RBCs, red blood cells. So septal capillaries will enlarge, they'll be filled up with RBCs, and small part of the fluid it may exude and it can accumulate in the alveolar lumen. A small part. This is the first stage. So when you examine this and gross, you will see lung becoming totally red in color. That's why we call it as stage of congestion. Okay, lungs become affected part of the lung will become more red in color, mainly because congestion of the alveolar capillaries. When you see under microscopy, these capillaries will be enlarged in size, filled with red blood cells. This is the first stage. What happens? The second stage. If it is not stopped at this stage, it will go to second stage. We call it as stage of red hepatization. Important word is red and it is hepatization. On gross, even the lung at this stage looks red in color, but here it is smooth or soft or spongy in consistency, but in second stage it takes the consistency of the liver. Okay, that's why you call it as hepatization. So why it takes the consistency of the liver? What exactly happens? Let's see in the microscopy. When the sections are taken at this stage, what happens? This is the first stage, what I mentioned. Second stage, what happens? These alveoli, if you recollect in the first class, they are very thin. They do not have any kind of a basement membrane. Whenever the pressure is increased in the interseptal capillaries, if the pressure is more, these capillaries will rupture. And more RBCs will start coming and collecting in the alveolar lumen. Initially, stage of congestion will have only the congested enlarged septal capillaries. Lumen is almost clear, or you may see occasional lymphocytes or occasional RBCs with very minimal fluid. Next stage, you will see numerous RBCs which are getting accumulated in the alveoli. When the RBCs are exuded from the blood vessels, you will have more of plasma also coming up. So whatever the air space in the alveolar lumen will be replaced by cells and also fluid. Hence, this part of the lung appears solidification, solid, it becomes solid. That's why we call it as hepatization. We call it as red because predominantly you have septal congestion. Along with that, many or numerous RBCs, they are present in the alveolar lumen. This is stage of red hepatization. Next, if you leave like that, then it will go for stage of gray hepatization. What exactly happens? So see the difference. It is still lung is red. When you see, when the lung goes to this stage, still the hepatization, still it is solid in color, but redness will be lost. You will see gray-white patches. Solid lung with gray-white patches, just like a consolidation. Then that stage, we call it a stage of gray hepatization. When you take sections at this stage, what exactly seen? So this is stage of congestion. This is stage of red hepatization. In stage of gray hepatization, what happens? Along with the RBCs, there are more and more number of WBCs will come into. they start accumulating. These are all WBCs. WBC is nothing but they are nucleated cells. So more and more WBCs will start accumulating, and the RBCs which are there in the alveolar lumen, they will be destroyed. So these alveoli, destruction of red blood cells and more accumulation of white blood cells in the alveolar lung, it loses the redness in color and it becomes gray color. That's why it is gray hepatization. One thing you should remember is RBCs, all of you know that the normal lifespan of the RBCs is about 120 days. If a normal RBC is circulating continuously in the vasculature and the blood circulation, its lifespan is 120 days. Once it comes out from the vessel wall, any kind of a vessel wall, extravascularly, it will not survive. So here it has come out. It has to be destroyed. Once it comes out, it stays there for some time, and within a day or two, this RBCs will be damaged. You will have hemoglobin and you will have iron. So to engulf, to clear off these red blood cells, you have, along with the white blood cells, you will have many macrophages. This is the symbol for macrophages. These macrophages will engulf a part of the hemosiderin pigment which is released by the destruction of RBCs. So in gray hepatization, you will see many white blood cells, alveolar macrophages, and also hemosiderin pigment laden macrophages. RBCs will be gone. So this is the microscopic picture of gray hepatization. Then the final stage is resolution. There is infection going from one stage to other. Ultimately, infection anywhere in the body has to resolve. So these RBCs or WBCs will be gradually taken out from this, or gradually disintegrated, and they will be cleared off by mononuclear cells, histiocytes, and it will become process of healing stage. This we call it as a stage of resolution. Alveoli will become normal. All the inflammatory cells will go off. Okay. All from gradually cleared up and everything will be healed. This is called stage of resolution. So when it heals, WBCs will come, all of you know that wherever you have inflammatory cells, they secrete a lot of cytokines. So when the cytokines are secreted here, the fibroblasts which are present in the alveolar interstitium, they also act. These cytokines will also act. That is fibroblast growth factor. So as a healing process, the fibroblasts also proliferate. And in the intermediate stage, these fibroblasts, they fill up. These are the elongated cells, fill up the alveolar lumen. Gradually it will be cleared off. So this presence of fibroblastic plug in the alveolar lumen, we call it as organization. Organization, and gradually this will be cleared. This is the stage of resolution. All of you remember, stage of congestion, you have only this congestion of the septal capillaries. Alveolar lumen, maybe occasional red blood cells. Next stage, numerous red blood cells with plasma in the alveolar lumen, no air, hence it is hepatization, still it is red in color. Gradually these RBCs will be broken down and it will be replaced by numerous white blood cells, alveolar macrophages, and also hemosiderin laden macrophages. Finally, there will be fibroblastic plug formation causing organization. Gradually it will be resolved and all the lung parenchyma, affected lung parenchyma, will become normal. So this is stage of resolution. All of you should remember. You can see the picture, what I have explained here, it is there and the microscopic pictures there. Stage of congestion is not there. The first picture what you are seeing is stage of gray hepatization. Then you have organization. The spindle shaped cells what you are seeing in the picture is nothing but some of the spindle shaped structures what you are seeing filling up the alveoli in the down picture, and also in the right corner, that is called as young fibroblastic proliferation, filling up the alveolar lumen. So this we call it as Mason body. Mason bodies, they are present in organizing pneumonia. The pneumonia and the organizing phase, these are nothing but young fibroblastic proliferation. Gradually it will dissolve. So we know the gross, the morphological variants of pneumonia, how it looks radiologically, how it looks pathologically by gross histology and also the microscopic histology samples. Then if you don't treat or if you don't take proper precautions for the prevention of pneumonia, what all can happen? That we call it as complications of pneumonia. Complication if you don't treat, it forms a diffuse damage to the lung parenchyma with necroinflammatory exudate. That we call it as cavitatory lung, leading to abscess formation. That is lung abscess. Once the lung is damaged, it is damaged. We'll have a big cavity filled with pus. Okay, the lung abscess is one of the most common complications of an untreated pneumonia. Second, there is infection in one part of the lung, it can spread to other part of the lung. That is spread. It can spread to other part of the lung. At the same time, the organisms which are present, causative organisms which are present in the lung, because lung is a very richly vascular organ, it can enter the hematogenous and the infections can spread to the other part of the body. Other parts of the body by hematogenous spread. Hematogenous spread. That is one of the important. If the lung is severely affected, all the lobes, both right and left lungs are affected, then ultimately causes respiratory failure. These are the complications. If you have lung abscess, what all can happen? The abscess can rupture into the thoracic cavity, leading to empyema thoracis. So these are the complications of pneumonia. Empyema thoracis, lung abscess, spread of the infection to the other part of the lung, other organs by hematogenous spread, and ultimately if it is severe, it causes severe respiratory failure. In the same pneumonia, we have the other category called as, all of you should know, because I am talking about pneumonia, you should know, there is other category, an important chapter called as interstitial pneumonia. So interstitial pneumonia, it's a separate chapter, very big chapter that I'm going to talk about in the near future. Because I mentioned pneumonia, I thought I will mention a definition of interstitial pneumonia. It is also a pneumonia, that means inflammation of the lung parenchyma, but the inflammatory cells are particularly limited to the interstitium. If you say alveoli, these are the alveoli, but whatever inflammation or major pathology, if it is present, it is present along the interstitium of the alveoli. Numerous inflammatory cells. Alveolar lumen is perfectly fine, or you may say very few inflammatory cells. So when you see this kind of a picture, where inflammatory process is predominantly limited to the alveolar septa without causing much damage to the lung parenchyma, alveolar lumen parenchyma, these categories as interstitial pneumonia. It is a very big chapter that I'll be going to talk about later. The most common cause is viral and idiopathic pneumonias. Okay. The next one is, one thing what you should remember is, we spoke about acute pneumonia, etc., etc., and few word about chronic pneumonia. What is this chronic pneumonia? Chronic pneumonia. The previous categories, what I mentioned, the most of them are acute pneumonia, community acquired pneumonias, atypical, typical, nosocomial pneumonia. They are more of acute. If infection persists, lung infection persists for many weeks, sometimes even months. Then we dump all those kind of pneumonias and label it as chronic pneumonias. Why it is important? It is very important because certain organisms, they are more prone to cause chronic pneumonia. What are those organisms? In Indian setup, first and foremost is tuberculosis. It causes chronic pneumonias. Tuberculosis, we'll be dealing about tuberculosis in later chapters. Next, we have various fungal infections. Tuberculosis and fungal infections are most common causes of chronic pneumonias. So, fungal infections, you have, what are those fungal infections? Histoplasma. I'll just name the organisms, the morphology and all, you will read in detail in microbiology. Histoplasma, we have Nocardia, and we have blastomycosis. Number three, you have coccidioidomycosis. So these are the common organisms which causes chronic pneumonia. I repeat, tuberculosis in Indian setup and developing countries, one of the four most common cause of chronic pneumonia, and rest is fungal infections. Okay. So, how to differentiate TB bacilli from Nocardia? For demonstration of TB bacilli, most common stain used is Ziehl-Neelsen stain. We call it as acid fast bacilli stain, AFB stain. All of you know, when you do AFB stains, you can easily differentiate the Mycobacterium tubercular organism with the Nocardia. Can you see the pictures here? The first picture shows the Mycobacterium tuberculosis. These are tiny, slender, beaded like structures. They're tiny. But when compared to the next picture, the Nocardia species, they have elongated branching acid fast bacilli. Both are acid, there will be acid, both will take up acid fast stain, that's certain stain. But by seeing at the morphology, you can differentiate whether it is a tubercle bacilli and whether it is a Nocardia bacilli. And for histoplasmosis, it's very difficult to diagnose clinically and also radiologically histoplasmosis. For clinically, radiologically, histoplasmosis, they look very much like tuberculosis. Very difficult to differentiate tuberculosis. Unless until you do a histopathological demonstration of the organism, it is very difficult. The clinical presentation, everything is more and similarly like tuberculosis. How it looks, if the biopsy is taken for demonstration of organisms to rule out tuberculosis, if it is histoplasma, how it looks? The proper lung excision for diagnosis of histoplasma usually you will not get nowadays because of improved non-invasive methods. If you see histoplasma on grass, how it looks? It forms a nodule like fibrotic nodule. Big fibrotic nodule. It is there in the, it is a book picture. You can make out the gray-white fibrotic nodule. It looks how it looks on grass examination. If you take sections from here and there is a microscopic examination, you will see histiocytic cells filled up with tiny organisms with clear space surrounding it. These organisms almost like 2 to 4 microns. Tiny organisms present predominantly intracellularly in the macrophages. It's how it looks under microscopy. This is the diagnosis and morphology of histoplasmosis. Blastomycosis, there are different stains. You can see a thick walled fungus with a small daughter. For blastomycosis, these are the special stains. What you will see? You will see thick walled fungus with a budding form. This is how it looks, the blastomycosis. Coccidioidomycosis will have a big spirule like organism with thick walled with thick wall, double thick wall, and you will see small microsporules inside the big organisms. This is how it looks under coccidioidal microscope. So this completes the lung infection lecture. Thank you.